Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Commissioners is now in session. Vice Chairman Bill Lashley will lead us in our invocation and pledge of allegiance.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time thanking you for this day and all the many blessings that you shower down on us each day. And as we set out to do the people's business, we ask for your guidance and directions. And we thank you and we ask you to bless us all. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I want to welcome everybody here, especially Commissioner Linda. You've been out for quite a while. Glad to have you back.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
I'm sure. We're really delighted to have you back. It's time for our public speakers. Megan?
So you might recognize me from last year. I went to the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Youth Summit last year, and I got the opportunity to interview Linda Massey last year. Well, this year, as the required interview, I decided to interview Tim Sutton since it's his last few months before he finishes his term out of 20 years. It's really an honor for me to be up here again because a lot of kids don't even get to do this. It's a big deal for most of them. And to get to be able to do it twice is great for me. I've learned a lot. Last year was great. I got to learn so many things. I learned a lot about what county government does. A lot of the things y'all do, I wouldn't have ever thought you did. So it's really nice to learn about it, and it's great to get the opportunity to get to speak in front of you. A little bit about me. I'm 17, and I go to middle college at ACC. I have been in 4-H for 9 years, I think it is. It's a long time. I've been in it since I was about 6 years old. And I focus on things like leadership and community service. And when I heard about the Youth Summit, I was really excited to get to do it because I didn't know anything about it. You guys just really inspire me to get more involved with my community because a lot of the things that I hear in these meetings, it just amazes me that it happens and it goes on. So thank you for everything that you do. And there are cups with pens in it. That's courtesy of Alamance County 4-H. And thank y'all.
Thank you, Megan.
Thank you,
Meg. Tony?
You know, it is amazing. She was talking about the stuff that goes on out here in the front of the things, but it's really funny the things that go on behind the scenes. You know, I come to these meetings and I listen to you with your prayers, and I wonder. And I listen to the Pledge of Allegiance with liberty and justice for all, which is a farce. It's amazing to me what the government of the United States of America has decided is constitutional and not constitutional. Back in 2007, I was called a lowly plumber. I'm still a lowly plumber. And you wouldn't believe what I see under houses. I lay in raw sewage, whatever it takes. I got a call this morning at 8 o'clock. I'm going to tell you about this one. Man said he had a leak in his basement. I couldn't understand him. And he wanted to know if I'd take a post-dated check. And I said, sir, I don't take post-dated checks. And I hung up and I said, wait a minute. You can't do that. And I called him back and I told him, I said, I won't take a post-dated check, but I will date that check today and won't cash it until the 1st. This guy's a veteran. He's in a wheelchair. He can't move. He takes dialysis with my dad over at DeVita. When somebody needs help, you got to help them, right? That's America. We got a lot of liars, cheats, thieves, wannabe thugs, and cowards that have run around and they have misused and abused their jobs and their authority in our government. Some are being taken care of. Others are coming along. I got a letter from the Assistant Attorney General on Saturday that said that I, along with my partner, have been cited for an ordinance violation back in 2007. That is a lie. I've never been charged, cited, applied for, appealed, anything under the High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance. And other things were said at this podium that we know were lies. I stand here before you today with my integrity intact. A lot of people are trying to cover for a lot of people, but I'm not stopping. It is my duty as an American to expose this stuff so that other people will not be hurt. And they will be helped. We don't want to be like Ukraine. We don't want to be like Israel, Palestine. That's not America. But I don't know why. Help somebody.
Thank you, Tom. The agenda was, anybody have anything on the consent agenda they want to pull or discuss? If not, do hear a motion to approve the agenda, which includes the consent agenda?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We now have a public hearing on the economic development in incentives for CS Carolina. Mac, do you want to come forward and say a few words before we start the public hearing?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I'm Mac Williams, President of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce. I'm here to introduce I.T. Jew, who is the President of CS Carolina, who has been working with staff on an incentive performance agreement. He's here to tell you tonight about the project itself and to answer any questions you or the public may have about it. So I'm happy to introduce to you I.T. Jew, President of CS Carolina.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and the member of the County Commission. I would like to introduce my company a little bit and then share with you our plans for our future project. We are CS Group. CS stands for Chilsung in Korean. Chilsung means seven star. I'm sure you guys are familiar with Samsung. Samsung actually means three star. So I pride myself, our company is double the better than Samsung. And we're going to make it, make that come true. And my company has been established back in 1964. Since then, we produced nylon and polyester yarn for textile industry and other industries. And we have, so we are actually largest and with the longest history in polyester yarn manufacturing from Korea. We still have operation in Korea, and we have operations in California, North Carolina, and El Salvador in Central America. We currently hire globally 450 full-time employees, with a revenue of $120 million annually. This is the location of our operations. Now, in the US, we have 65 full-time employees, some in California, some in North Carolina. And we produce annually 24 million pounds of polyester and nylon yarn for the industry. And what we do is mainly, we mainly do synthetic nylon and polyester filament yarn we produce. And our yarn goes into we produce polyester and nylon yarn, and our product goes into apparel, automotive, home furnishings, many different industry in the U.S. As you can see, one of our biggest destination is the athletic performance garments, and also it goes into the automotive car seats and headliners and home furnishings and other interiors. Our investment plan is we're going to install a brand new state-of-the-art machine and expand our capacity for another 10 million pounds a year. And we would like to do it in Burlington if everything comes and adds up. That's our plan. We currently have our people working in Swepsonville, and we would like to keep our people for this expansion. And we are going to hire 22 new employees with this new expansion.
Is that a woven material?
I'm sorry?
Is that a woven material? Is it woven?
Woven material?
Woven.
We produce yarn. So our customer will wove. Yeah.
Okay.
We don't make the fabrics.
Okay.
And we would like to create more jobs in this county and give opportunity to many people in this county. And our vision is to become a channel of blessing so that we want our presence to be blessings to our customers, our employees, local society, and also to our suppliers. And our employees already enjoying this blessings together through our company, and we want to expand this opportunity through this expansion in Alamance County. We've been in this business more than 50 years, and we know the best in this industry, and we want to focus on what we do the best. And we believe in Made in USA. The manufacturing is coming back. We believe because of our expansion, there's going to be more investment of fabric mills, other industries coming into this area. And this has actually happened when we did the same expansion and investment in El Salvador. We were able to bring more fabric textile industry into the area. So we want to do the same in Alamance County. And we are not completely new in this area. We already have a very good, strong customer base. And we would like to expand and supply and provide better service to the customers. Lastly, we have other offers and options in where we should put this expansion and new plant, but we believe Alamance County is the best option for us, especially for our existing people. We don't have to lose them, and with the very competitive energy cost of this area, and with the support from the city and the county and from the state, we believe we can be very competitive. So we would like to ask your support on our project. Every support counts and make us more competitive. And then we will spend $7.1 million in machines and building new buildings for this new project. This is just phase one of our project. We would like to continue our growth and expansion with this county if everything works well. So we appreciate your support, and then we're looking forward to make this project reality. And I would like to prove that this was a good support, and it was a good blessing for the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Commissioners, have any questions for Mr. Q?
He did refer to you're in North Carolina. Somewhere else? Where is that?
Right now we are at Graham. It's like between Swepson and Graham. It's kind of.
You're in Graham now.
Yes. Right now, Graham. But we are very small right now. But we would like to expand and become a meaningful player in the region.
Any other questions?
We're glad you're here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
sir. Appreciate it. Any comments by the commissioners before we go into a public hearing? I hear a motion to go into public hearing for the economic development incentives of CS Carolina.
So moved.
Your second.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right. Anybody who has comments, I'll start on this side. Anyone on my right side, your left side, want to make any comments concerning CS Carolina? All right, on my left, anybody? Eddie?
How much are they asking for?
Matt?
I believe it's 2% for,
I think it's like
$142,000, and that would be paid over a five-year period. So that would be $28,400 annually. But we also looked at the taxes that would be paid on the $7.1 million, which would be $37,630.
Anything else, Eddie? Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah, go ahead.
I don't know this out there to anybody. And maybe fine companies, maybe the best deal you get for the money anywhere. But I'm starting to notice a trend with these people coming with less than 50 jobs. And which we know the 50 is the mandate for the insurance. Then they're saying that we use this as a not medium, but an average salary. I think you kind of need to start watching, get a median salary, see if there are we going to wind up subsidizing the employees through Obamacare and tax incentives and stuff like that. In other words, I think this is mostly machinery from the looks of it, and may not fit the example that I'm trying to make, but I think it's something we need to start keeping an eye on, because we have local lamp that came here a year or so ago, if you remember. And it was strange to me, this big company wanted to spin off this little thing to the side with 50 people. I mean, you know, this is an international company, so a pretty big company around here anyway. And I'm getting suspicious that we're going to get took, if we haven't already, with subsidizing two ways. Do you understand what I'm saying? So if when you make these things up, Mac comes with them and Mr. Honeycutt gets them off, if we could give a little more detail, it might keep us from making a mistake to where we're just really just subsidizing some company that wants to spin off and get out of tax liabilities and have us pay for insurance liabilities and stuff like that. I hope if they grasp what I'm saying. That these numbers, like, you know, where you get 100 employees, no big deal. You know they're going to come under mandates and stuff. But when you get these smaller numbers, I really got suspicious about the problem when a company that big wanted to make a little operation over here with 50 employees. I said, but that's y'all doing, and that's all I got to say.
I'd like to bring something to the board's attention also.
concerns.
Mac, just a minute.
Mac raised his
hand. Just in response to the issue of public employees, the 22 jobs that Mr. Jew referred to are brand new jobs in addition to the 28 jobs that currently exist. So this is sort of it's a retention and an expansion at the same time. So they'll end up with I guess right on the number of 50, plus they already have insurance anyway themselves. So if that helps any, just to clarify that this isn't just a 22 person, the new jobs are 22, but they already have, in addition to that, 28 existing jobs.
What's the pay range of these employees?
The average in the agreement's $35,100.
Is that benefits or is that base?
I believe it says average wage, so that would be just the wage. $35,100 for the 22 new.
Tony?
Thank you for allowing me to speak. One of the things that I've noticed, being this was brought up by Mr. Shue, needing to know more about these companies coming in asking for these incentives programs. I've contacted Mr. Williams on a couple of occasions and wanted to attend a board meeting, and was told that the board meetings are not open to the general public. Now, as a taxpayer, I believe I do subsidize the Chamber of Commerce. And for me not to be allowed, you know, for the general public to be able to spot things maybe and come in here, you know, things are tight. But we're not allowed to attend their public meetings. I don't know why.
Anyone else on this side of the room have anything to say in the public hearing? Anybody? Hearing or seeing none, is there a motion that we go out of the public hearing?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any of the commissioners have any comments they'd like to make? John?
Yes. One, Mr. Cox, just in response to our agendas and our whole agenda packet, is public information, it's on the computer, and you can get that anytime. And a lot of the numbers we've talked about right here are already published numbers. So the number of jobs, the average salary, those sort of things are available to the general public. We're not trying to keep anything from you guys at all, trying to make you as informed as we possibly can. Mr. Honeycutt?
Yes, sir.
Or maybe Mr. Manning. What will they be paying based upon the $7.1 million per year in taxes?
$37,630.
All right, that's what I had. And so roughly we're going to net an additional $10,000 per year for the first 5 years, and then that amount following that.
Roughly, yes, sir.
In taxes. Okay, thank you.
Well, I'd like to make a point that they would have paid it all had they come without the incentives. So, you know, you're gambling that they wouldn't have come without it. It's the old debate of whether they would come or not if you didn't give it to them.
That's
some
true.
Buy it, some don't.
Anything else from the board?
Yes, I'd like to say I am going to vote no to it being due to the reason that it's a cash incentive, cash, money. And Mac, if you need to explain this a little further, please do. I'm in favor of infrastructure that other people can hook on to, other industries, i.e. land, i.e. water, i.e. roads, and so forth. But I am diametrically opposed to giving money. And I voted that way for close to a decade now. My parents were into textiles. My father, I was raised on textile money. Went to college on textile money, so I'm certainly not opposed to textiles. I wish you the best. But my principle is to vote no on cash, not against textiles. So good luck.
Anything else from the board? Is there a motion?
So moved. I mean, I'll make the motion that we accept that.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Motion passes 4-1. Thank you very much, Mr. Chu and Mac. Appreciate it. And good luck to you. Okay. Clyde?
Yes, sir.
Purchase offer and sale agreement.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Clyde, I'm here. Mr. Garbite.
On the 16th of June, you passed a resolution authorizing the publication of the bid of Peak Industries for $3.9 million. And we published that on June 19th. The bids ran as required by statute, and on June 30th at 12 p.m., there were no upset bids. So the offer before you tonight is to accept or reject the offer of Peak Industries to purchase the property at 600 North Main Street and 217 College Street and 779 Woody Drive for $3.9 million. And if you do choose to accept that, I would ask that the motion also include that the manager be given full authority to sign all the documents necessary to close the transaction.
Any questions? Any discussion?
I'd move that we accept the offer.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye. Motion as stated by the county attorney.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
Stober?
He is not here this evening. I will be Cy Stober this evening. What presenting tonight is a request from the planning board for a hardship. We received a waiver from Ms. Isabel Mabel Hunt, who's in the process of trying to subdivide her property. In accordance to our subdivision ordinance, she needed a 50-foot access road. After years, and very simply, after years and years of trying every which way she could not get the road or the feet necessary to do a 50-foot access road. She could only do a 30-foot road. She is asking for a waiver from this part of our subdivision ordinance. And that has to be approved by the Board of Commissioners. This has been reviewed by the planning, excuse me, the planning board, and the planning board has recommended approval.
Any questions on this issue?
I don't have a question, but I got a statement. When that ordinance was being, came through the commissioners, we voted against that 50-foot front, that road frontage, because it's unbelievable that we have forced the taxpayers to build a home and put a 50-foot road on it. We voted for a 30-foot road, not a 50-foot road. So she don't need an ordinance because that was never passed. I made the motion to take it out, and it should have been in the book, in the paperwork.
Okay, we'll go back and check that. Yes, sir.
Please do.
If it was not done, what we'll probably have to do is we will bring that as a recommendation back to the planning board. Okay. To take that out, and then that will come back to the board.
I don't want it to go back to the planning board. Oh. They don't have a thing to say about it.
Yes, sir.
So it comes to commissioners.
Yes, sir.
I'm Elizabeth Hunt. I'm the one with the property.
Okay.
I have a 30-foot easement.
That's all you should have. That's all you should have to have.
Good. Well, I couldn't get it from anybody.
It's just ridiculous to expect the people to put a road in to their home at that big of a road. It's ridiculous.
Well, the problem is the man across the street has a fence.
Yeah.
And it's a long story. And I have
thoughts
involved. So thank you for approving it.
Why don't we do this and go ahead and pass the
waiver.
The waiver for.
Okay. I'll make the motion and we pass that waiver.
Then hopefully you'll follow through with what.
We'll yes, sir. Okay. We'll give them that direct. Yes, sir.
All right.
We'll make that change.
Okay. Can you make a motion, Bill?
Sure, I just made a motion.
Is there a second to
I'll
it?
I'll second.
Linda? Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
And one of these days, my voice is going to get better where I can make more sense up here.
Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have a request working with our partners in Graham and Mebane. As part of the Hallfields Economic Development Zone and as part of getting the site ready for construction, they're in the process of doing the water and sewer lines. There are a couple of buildings that are on the easements that had to be removed that they were unaware of. They are removing the buildings themselves using Graham and Mevin labor, equipment, and trucks. We don't have any of the labor costs, but what they have asked is if we could waive the tipping fees at our landfill as our contribution to part of this project. Right now, I said $1,500. It may be between $1,500 and $2,000, but they're asking that we could waive the tipping fees for that debris.
And that's our contribution to the partnership?
Yeah, that would be our third on this small piece. Yes, sir.
We have a motion to waive the tipping fee for, I guess, the...
The Hall, or the Hall Fields demolition for the water and sewer that will be put in.
Is there a motion to waive it?
I'll make the motion.
There's a second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. Ms. Haygood.
Well, good evening, Commissioners. I'm here tonight to present to you the proposed goals for county government departments for the 2014-15 Performance Management Program. No action required by you tonight. This is to give you an opportunity to see and go over and look at the goals that the departments have put together. Y'all are very familiar with the Performance Management Program. It has two tiers, goal setting as well as savings retention. All the departments participate in the savings part of the program, and the goal setting part is voluntary. Please report this year that all departments are participating in setting goals, except the planning department, being as that we are without staff in that department and didn't have no staff as we put together goals. We'll work with them once they get some folks on board. But I wanted to let you know, as you look at these goals, you should have a copy of them. You provided a copy for you to review. Total number of them for across all departments is 186. The goals were put in together with the thought in mind that they should ensure services to the public are good and high quality, and they should also create efficiencies. You can kind of take this list and break down the types of goals that are in there into three types. One is public service by the county directly to citizens. And some good examples of goals set this year that fit that category would be CCOM is proposing they'll be able to answer all 911 calls in 10 seconds or less, which is a great boon to the residents. EMS is proposing this year as one of its goals that within 90, they will roll an ambulance within 90 seconds of being dispatched, which is an excellent service goal to the community. And another good example is environmental health and the county building inspections are proposing they will conduct 100% of their building and well and wastewater inspections on the same day request. So that's a fantastic thing for general public to know. That's their goal. That's what they're shooting for. Then you have some of these goals that are interdepartmental. There are some county departments that provide service to other county departments. They really don't serve the general public directly. They serve county departments. Some good examples in there. The maintenance department is setting a goal of 81% for all maintenance work orders completed in one business day, which is pretty good. They get a huge volume of work orders. Another good example would be the county legal department is their goal is to answer 100% of service inquiries. That's a very good goal. I'm sure many of you know they get a lot of inquiries from department heads, contract review, tons of work, and their goal is to get it all done at 100%. Then you have some goals. You have some we're talking about, some are for the public, some are for internal, and we have some that are efficiency that specifically target savings. Some good examples of this would include some of the goals out of Cooperative Extension, where they're setting goals for volunteers, for master gardeners. That saves the county money. These folks work at the facility there on North Graham Hopedale, as well as they help people that come in and provide counsel and service for people with their shrubs. We also have some efficiency goals set by DSS, where DSS is, again, this year going to make it a priority to try to use as much state and federal dollars as they can before they tap into county tax dollars, which is good news for all of us. So, the department heads submitted these goals to county management. County manager appointed a committee to review all the goals, then to get with department heads and fine-tune those goals. That committee was composed of Susan Osborne, Cindy Brady, Richard Hill, and Tim Britt. So this committee took all the goals, reviewed them, went back and forth with department heads, asked a lot of questions, got input from county management, fine-tuned the goals. They were given to the county manager, who reviewed them all, had several suggestions, and has approved what you have in front of you this evening. This is an opportunity for you to look them over, If you have any questions or comments, I'll try to answer them if I can. What we'll do after tonight, if you're in agreement with the goals that you have in your hand tonight, these will all be posted online for the general public to look at. We're gonna, we've created a form for reporting, so we can report every month how the departments are progressing with their goals. That'll be put online, be available for you to see, or the general public if they want to keep up with how departments are doing. Then in December, I will come back before you with a report, just an update of where departments are, how things are faring, are we on track to meet our goals, or are we struggling in some areas? And then, of course, at the end of the fiscal year, I'll be back to tell you how we fare. So I'm here this evening to answer any questions, and I think that these are good. I think they've been well formulated.
You asking for approval?
No need to vote. Just if you have any questions about them, if you feel comfortable about them, just the consensus from the board is enough for me. We'll proceed from there.
Any questions?
I certainly feel comfortable with them. I've looked over them and read them all. That's very good. You've done some really good homework on those.
All right. Well, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. I kind of get the feeling the train just came through here as fast as we've gone through this agenda tonight.
We ain't quite through you.
It's liable to heat up.
Uh-oh. We've been warned.
I'm just kidding.
It's all right, Tim. Anytime, you know that. Mr. Finance Officer.
You know what they say, the calm before the storm?
Yeah, I've heard of it. I know that for sure.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Hello.
Good evening.
I have a couple of items here I'd like to update the board on. Vice Chair Mr. Lashley had asked early on, how soon can we get a feel for what our fund balance is going to look like at year end? And I want to discuss that and offer a projection with certain contingencies, of course. In order to do that, I just want to briefly go over fund balance accounting. Not that there's going to be a test, but what fund balance are we going to look at? We have our choice of at least 8 different terms that we've heard from time to time on what constitutes a fund balance and why should we care what's in the fund balance. There they are, restricted by state statute, restricted by other committed, also known as appropriated, unassigned, also known as undesignated, available, and what the total is. The numbers you see on the right-hand side are what we actually had in those categories at the end of June of last year, June 2013. Very quickly, the restricted by state statute simply means those funds that we are expecting but have not received need to be considered as a certain restricted block. And typically, they fall into 2 major categories, due from other governments. Best example of that is if we're waiting and have committed to receiving grant funding, but it's not here yet, then it's basically a receivable from other government. Other receivables include things like operating receivables where people actually owe the county or companies owe the county. Best example would be our EMS collection service, where basically the billings are made, we get the money, 30 days, 60 days, and so forth. Deferred amounts are those amounts in those categories that aren't really due within the next 12 months, and so we can take them back out of that category. But those are receivables that are restricted by law. All other includes money we have received but haven't put to use yet. Good example of that is if Parks and Rec receives a grant for the purchase of, say, land next to Cedar Rock Park, but the money has not been expended. We have the land, but it is designed and it's restricted for specifically that purpose. The grants come in, we hold the money. Once they are spent, then obviously they go out of restricted. Commissioners have the authority to restrict and commit funds for specific purposes. We have primarily 2 right now. We have set aside money in our last 2 budgets to get ready for the next revaluation process. Those funds are there to help with staffing, resources. That's money that the board has said, okay, we want to put this money aside for that purpose. Similarly, economic development, when we approve incentives to be held for a particular project, they will go into that category, as you did this evening. The unassigned balance basically is the total less those 3 categories. So you hear about unassigned or undesignated fund balance, that's what's left over. $17 million as of last year. again, taking out what's restricted by state statute, everything else, and what is committed. Therefore, the total is the sum of all the categories: restricted, restricted for other, committed, unassigned. Now, what you don't see up there is probably the most important element, and that is what's called available. And available simply is, if we look, it doesn't want to go backwards on me, if we look at the total fund balance, the $26 million, and we take out strictly that amount restricted by state statute, it comes to $20 million. That is the number that the Local Government Commission reviews and uses to calculate the relative strength of our county fund balance compared to others. So, given all that, what fund balance is most important to us? It's actually the available down there at the bottom. We have the total fund balance less what's restricted by state, and the Local Government Commission looks, and as of last year, that number is $20 million. Okay, so where are we going? Looking at 2012, that available fund balance was $14 million. That's when we received the now infamous letter. Our total fund balance percentage at the time, the 11.3%, was based on that $14 million in relation to our expenditures of $123 million. 2013 improved greatly. The available fund balance went to the $20 million you just saw in the analysis. Net expenditures, $121 million. Available fund balance percentage, 16.5%. We believe we're on course now to add another $5 million this year, the year that just ended. There are some accruals that need to be adjusted. There are some contingencies that may affect it a little bit. But basically, we feel pretty comfortable, and Mr. Lashley, for you, of saying, okay, we think $5 million can be added to this thing. If we do, based on our current budget expenditures of $127 million, it should take the available fund balance percentage to 19.7%. I feel good about that. It's not where our peer average was that we looked at on our county's similar size. However, looking at where we have come from in just 2 years, from 11.3% up to 19.7% is quite an improvement. Peer average for 2012, which was the latest number we have, was 24.7%. Again, the 11.3% is the year that we received the wonderful letter saying that we needed to put some more resources in this area, which we did. So, the year just ended. Susan Roberts is in the process right now of completing the closing entries for June. We should have the year closed out within a day or two. Our auditors are scheduled to come in the first week of August, which is the week after next, and we feel very confident that we'll be able to have a firm number on that within a pretty short time. The reason we don't have the official document typically till later in the fall is because once we have our numbers, then it has to go to the Local Government Commission. They have to recommend whatever changes they make, which are typically none to minimal, and then they have to bless it, go back to our auditors, and we get the final statement sometime in November or December. So I think that's where we'll be. Obviously, we have some programs in place, such as the performance-based budgeting. The $1.2 million or so that was allocated to the program for the current year will be basically out of unassigned and into the committed category as we look at ways departments want to spend that money. Again, that won't affect the future revenue expense, but rather it'll come out of this fund balance. The other thing I wanted to point out, very briefly, I bring this to you from time to time, and I actually have good news to report on this, kind of our Alamance County employment situation. I've told you in the past that, yes, unemployment figures are still going down, but our labor force has shrunk. And actually now we're seeing signs of an actual recovery. What has happened is our labor force peaked in October 2012 at about 74,000. 74,000 in the labor force. It started to go down. It continued to go down during the year 2013. You can see May, which was 12 months ago, labor force was down to 73,000. It kept going down. January of 2014, it reached its lowest level of 71,000 there on the last line, 71,489. Since that time, it actually has gradually increased. May of 2014, you can see the number is 72,661, which is a difference of about 1,200 people in the labor force. As far as the number of employed, you can see that number has gone up as well, 614 new jobs. There was a time when I told you that our labor force was shrinking and the number of jobs changed was like plus 14, even though the unemployment rate was coming down. This time the unemployment rate continues to decline, 6.4%. Our number of unemployed has gone down, labor force has gone up, and the number of jobs have increased. So all that is very, very positive. Any questions about that?
Will you go back to the slide before that, please?
Yes.
That 19.7, that's even at 53 cents, right?
That does not affect the tax decrease. That actually will be what we have now before the 53 cents goes into effect. Yes, sir.
Okay. What do you think it will go to on the 53?
Based on the budget that we have, we are scheduled to use what's called appropriated fund balance. That is to take money out of the fund balance. So I don't think we'll see an increase next year of $5 million. Mm-hmm. I think we could see that $25 million decline by as much as $2.5 million if we use everything that's appropriated. Mm-hmm. But we have some good things going on out there too. Sales tax revenue is good. We're actually having a very good increase in our motor vehicle tax collection. The reason is now, as many of you know, in order to get your tag, you got to pay your tax. Our collection rate in the old system, where you got your tag and then your tax bill came 90 days later, our collection rate was around 86%. This way, it's going to go pretty close to 100%. And that's a big increase for our county. Sales tax revenue, Craig, what else? We've got good opportunities with respect
property
to
tax,
our property tax base increasing. Some of the new projects that we've talked about in here, as Sheets, a Walmart, and the supporting businesses come around, all that lends itself to very positive things. So even if the $2.5 million may be used out of appropriated balance, I think it could be more than offset by additional revenue coming in.
So you think that 19.7 could remain stable? Or
I'd like to see it personally go above 20%, but yes, I don't think it will significantly decline. I think we're in pretty good shape. I'm pleased. Any other questions about that? Mr. Chairman, I do have one other item that I don't know where it is. We have a budget amendment, a small one, for veterans area. Brenda Perry is here. She has reported to this board in the past. I honestly don't know what I do with it. I'll get it in a minute. But budget amendment is for $1,000. Brenda's been doing a lot of homework on her Veterans Day parade. This will be the first Veterans Day parade in the county, and she has contacted the high school bands. She's talked to a lot of different veterans groups, and the budget amendment recommendation is to allocate $1,000 for her in her efforts. The reason is a lot of the high school bands, that's right in the middle of their football season, and we feel like a small stipend of, say, $100 per school might be in order. She might have some other expenses in getting some of the groups that she wants to attend the parade to come here. So somewhere real close to here, I've got a budget amendment for $1,000 that I will get to you. But Brenda, did you want to add anything to that? And if y'all have any questions about that, but I would like to.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. Mr. County Manager.
Nothing new to update. Again, I do want to thank the work our county attorney did on the sale of the property and the land swap and how that worked out. And we're in the process, once we do get a closing date, of how we're looking at reorganizing the College Street building where we can place those services. So we're in the process, but I did want to publicly thank Clyde for the work that he did. It was not an easy agreement to come up with, but I think it's one that will benefit the county overall as we move forward.
When do you anticipate starting to throw dirt, Clyde?
Mr. Nunn has indicated it will be sometime in September, the closing. I suggested to him that if you closed it earlier, he wouldn't have to pay rent to the county on the Woody Drive property.
Commissioner's comments. John, I think you have one.
We currently have, well, let me back up. In addition to being a county commissioner, I'm on six different committees. One of those six is Parks and Rec. They do a wonderful job. We just had donated to us an entire island in Saxwell Hall. And that's due in large part to two Brians. Brian Haygood, who's the current director of Parks and Rec, but also the assistant county manager. Also Brian Baker, who does a wonderful job, because Brian Haygood's job is, well, he has two jobs. He's acting as a full-time, although we call him a part-time assistant county manager, and we call him a full-time director of Parks and Rec, but he can't be, you can't do two full-time jobs and so forth. Although Brian Haygood has done a wonderful job.
He really has.
And we really appreciate what you've done. What I'm trying to say is this. Brian Baker is basically he's the trails and open space coordinator. He's involved in the Mountains to Sea project and so forth. He's brought in over $2.3 million in grants and so forth in that capacity. We need a full-time Parks and Rec director, and we need a full-time assistant county manager. Based upon that, I would move that Brian Haygood be appointed as a full-time, not a part-time, assistant county manager, and that the county manager be requested to reorganize the Recreation Department to fill the full-time director position being vacated by Brian Haygood.
I'll second that motion. Is that a motion?
It is a motion.
Yes. I'll second the motion.
Any questions, comments?
Yeah, I'd like to discuss it a little bit. Number one, I've got several objections to this process as of today. Nothing against Brian at all. It's just a technicality. You know, we're barely 3 weeks into the budget year, fiscal year, and here we are expanding government, clearly. And this balloon was floated at budget time and basically didn't go anywhere. I have a problem with it coming in 3 weeks into the fiscal year, as we're doing tonight. You are on the Parks and Recreation, as you stated. Was this a board vote? Did the board vote on this as well, their board?
At our last meeting, I didn't make that a public announcement at the board meeting until our last meeting, last week, I guess. And the board had a unanimous vote to approve this with the Parks and Rec board.
Right. So they did. There was a board vote.
Yes, sir.
When this was done, when we combined both, when Tim Burgess left, it was my understanding that we combined the positions in an effort to save money, to consolidate some job duties, and to see if we couldn't be innovative with how we delegated the responsibilities of county government. And some counties don't have a rec department. Some counties don't even have an assistant county manager. And at least we did improve along the lines of going from two assistant county managers to one. Now, when Brian took this job, it was his salary was raised $19,000 from the base that he was receiving at REC, is my understanding, $19,000 plus. If I'm correct, somebody correct me. $19,000 plus. He received a $4,200 a year raise when we gave 5% raises, so he's received $23,000 plus in extra monies. And then another $20-some hundred, is my understanding, is what he's received when we took longevity pay and put it into permanent base salaries. So I don't think he's underpaid. That's my personal opinion. And I honestly believe that the duties have been handled well under his auspices at that level. But, you know, and it's my understanding that the county has not recommended this, according to Craig Honeycutt. Is that correct?
Staff has not pushed this.
Okay, you're not pushing it. I understand Brian's not pushing it, obviously. And it's my understanding it's not a county recommendation, short of coming off their rec committee. But my biggest complaint is coming in on July the, whatever the date is, 21st?
21st.
21st. And we just, we haven't got 3 weeks under our belt for a fiscal year. And with the denials that we made with raises, with the denials that we made with rejob classifications and so on, I just find this not to be in continuity with what we just did 3 weeks ago. So I will vote no, and God bless everybody who votes the other way, and Brian Haygood, whatever happens. So that's all I have to say.
Mr. Chairman, may I just address that issue? I did speak to Brian Haygood and to Mr. Honeycutt as both and asked for their approval, and I understand that neither opposed this at all, and I felt like they both were very supportive of this motion. Now, I understand in their positions it would be extremely awkward for them to bring this at this point to the county commissioners, but I feel like that as a county commissioner I have an obligation to do what's best for this county, and part of that's Parks and Rec, and part of that's an assistant county manager. If you want to look at the numbers, Ms. Haygood's salary is $89,256. The salary range for assistant county managers for comparable counties is a low of $73,939 and a high of $118,304. So he's right in the middle of that range. The previous assistant county manager for Alamance County made $94,172. So he's considerably below what you guys, and I was not on the board at that time, were paying the assistant county manager before Mr. Haygood agreed to take that position. So I feel like, and I also talked to Tom Manning, and my understanding is, Mr. Manning, that this is not going to be, well, for one thing, Mr. Haygood has not asked for an additional increase in salary. So I don't know whether his salary would increase or not. I assume that would be up to this board and would require a budget amendment for his salary to go up. He certainly is entitled to more, but that's not part of this motion. I just feel like we're doing the county a service. You mentioned that some counties don't have assistants, some counties don't have a Parks and Rec department. I'd rather live in Alamance County than I would in those counties.
What's the total swing in your projection of what the money swing will be? Because there's going to be a money swing.
Currently, Mr. Baker's salary is $51,972. As a director, I don't know whether his salary will go up or not. That would be up to Mr. Manning, the numbers you come up with, obviously, and Mr. Honeycutt, what your recommendations are, and that's not part of this motion either. I do think that we would then need to replace the City of Trails or the position that Brian Baker has, and so there will be an additional salary there.
He's going to... He's going to be doing a different job completely.
Yeah, an entirely different job is correct.
Well, give me an estimate.
Well, wait a minute. But if we cut out that other position, Brian Baker's current position, we're cutting out $2.3 million in grants that he's brought in. I think that's saving a nickel and throwing away $100.
One point on his salary, too. His salary was raised, is my understanding, how much was it raised when he was given the extra duties out of rec?
Brian
Baker,
Baker's.
Yeah, 40 some hundred.
I didn't bring his last salary beforehand.
But we mentioned that when I talked to you this afternoon.
Yeah, I didn't bring
that
with me.
Yeah, his salary. Well, again, I'm willing to be outvoted here. I'm just saying that it's my belief that what we're doing is not good for the county. You believe it is, so it's just a difference of opinion. Let's vote.
Let me throw one more number at you. The cities of Burlington and Graham kick in $13,000 of that salary for the Trails and Open Space Coordinator. So that's not even all of it coming out of our pockets anyway.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Motion passes 4-1. I have one issue. At this time, several meetings ago, we had some citizens come in and they had some complaints about the fire departments, and we asked the manager to look into it, and he did, and I think each of us received what he had suggested doing, if anything, And after I received it, I did talk to a lot of the fire people, including former fire marshal here tonight. And I was assured that the way the fire departments are set up now, that the same kind of appeal process or complaint process is in effect now, that the manager recommended in his proposal. It's my feeling that this board does not need to get involved in the fire departments in Alamance County. I think they do an excellent job, and I think they can handle their own, and they don't need another level of bureaucracy at all. And I would like to suggest that this particular issue be dropped and let the fire departments continue doing the excellent job that they do.
If that's a motion, I'll second it.
Any other comments on that? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I think I'm the one that recommended that we look into having an avenue, so I'll vote no.
Okay. Motion passed.
So I'll be consistent.
Four to one.
May I make one other comment?
Sure.
Ms. Haygood, we appreciate what you're doing, and congratulations with the promotion. I assume it's a promotion.
Thanks.
And Mr. Honeycutt, you have a job now to find a director, I guess.
And we'll come back with you hopefully at our next meeting, because there will be a budget amendment that will be required to fill both positions. So we will come back to you with those figures as well.
Brian, let me say that everything that I hear from the employees in this county, you are the top guy that they go to get things done. And I want to congratulate you as the new county assistant manager. We're glad you're here. We're glad you stay in Alamance County. We want you to stay.
His wife works for Elon. He can't get
it. That's right. That's good.
Besides, I told him that he had a no-cut contract. So.
His father is one of my neighbors. I can't get rid of these eggs. Did I hear a motion to adjourn?
Seven.
All in favor?
7:00 p.m. to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.